So we're going to talk here a little bit about the convergence of power series. Now, the power series, this is going to be something like this. If you haven't seen a summation in a while, then that just basically means that first of all, n is 0, then it's 1, then it's 2, then it's 3, and then it's blah, 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 all the way to infinity. So it means that you've got a naught, x minus x naught. These are the different naught. That's just like a general point, singularity to the 0. And then a1 is x minus x naught to the first, and then a2, x minus x naught squared, and a3, x minus x naught cubed, and on and on and on and on, like that. Beautiful? Very exciting. Okay, so that's a power series. You might say, well, I know that that's 1. Absolutely. So let's go ahead and do that. So I have that y is equal to a naught, a1, this thingy, a2, this thingy, a3, this thingy. It's a pattern. All right, so there's a power series. Now, convergence of power series is important because some series never converge, some series always converge, and some series only converge sometimes. So basically, that's not that helpful, but there's basically a couple of different ways that you can tell. So either two things are going to happen. So either x minus x naught is going to be equal to 0. And, well, how about, I don't want to say it like that. Either, one, it only converges when, I'll say it that way, it only converges when x minus x naught is equal to 0, which would make sense, because then it would converge clearly to a naught, because all the other terms would be 0. So there, it converges, like that. Okay, so it converges to a naught. So that's one option, is it can only converge whenever that happens. And aside from that, it's going to converge, and I'll say this kind of funny, if the n plus 1 term is less than the n term. And there's kind of some other ways in this, or it could also oscillate but we're not really going to look at that right now. Really, I'm just going to focus on this guy. Is it will either only converge whenever it's basically adding up a bunch of zeros, which is a total waste of time anyway, or we'll say it's only going to converge if the upcoming term is smaller than the term I've got. So if you think about something that converges, like 1/2 plus 1/4 plus 1/8, like if I go halfway through the door and halfway through what's remaining and halfway through what's remaining, etc., that is going to converge eventually to, I'm going to make it all the way through the door, but I never will because it's infinity. But that is going to converge because the upcoming term is smaller. Whereas if I have a power series whenever I write it out and I have it like this, well then clearly that's never going to converge because that's going to go to infinity over time because the next term is bigger. So one of the things that we can do is if we're given a generalized power series, so say we have something like the sum as n equals 0 to infinity of n factorial over x to the n, what I can do is I can say, okay, well, what is the n plus 1 term? That's the n plus 1 term. And is the ratio of the n plus 1 term over the n term, is that ratio less than 1? And if so, when? Because if it is less than 1, then the series is going to converge. If it's equal to 1, it's never going to converge. If it's greater than 1, it's never going to converge unless you have a 0, like unless x is 0 kind of thing. That was that first case. So basically, in what conditions is this going to converge? And this is actually pretty straightforward. And so in order to see if it's going to converge eventually, we want to look at this as the limit of n approaches infinity. So as n approaches infinity, is this here going to converge? Like that. Pretty? Got it? All right, so let's look at that. So we can say that the limit as n approaches infinity of the absolute value of, so what we have here, we've got n plus 1 factorial is the same thing as n plus 1 times n factorial. X to the n times x is the same as x to the n plus 1. And the only reason I would write it like that is so that certain things would cancel out. Do-do-do-do and do-do-do-do. So I have the limit as n approaches infinity of x times n plus 1. And actually, that's all I have left. When is that less than 1? Okay, so I'm going to keep making progress. So I can pull the x out because it's not dependent on that. And so this is actually interesting because what I see is that this is the absolute value of x, but the limit as n approaches infinity here, that's actually infinity. And infinity is never less than 1, so we can say that this never happens, never converges. Another way to say that is that the radius of convergence is 0 because there is no radius under which it converges. So this is actually an example of the first thing, which says it's only going to converge, we'll say, unless the only time it's going to converge is if x equals 0. And if x equals 0, then it's a very, very boring summation indeed. And now if I actually look at this and write the terms out, it's going to be pretty obvious right from the start that this isn't going to converge. So I have 0 factorial times x to the 0. So 0 factorial is 1. I'll just write it out. Times x to the 0. 1 factorial times x to the 1st. 2 factorial x squared, 3 factorial x cubed, and so on. So I've got 1 plus x plus 2x squared plus 6x cubed, and so on and so forth. So clearly those numbers are getting bigger and bigger and bigger, so that series is never going to converge. So it's a radius of convergence of 0. All right, so let's look at a second one. Let's say we want to find the limit of convergence on this series. Say so the sum is n equals 0 to infinity, negative 1 to the n, x to the n, n factorial. So I'm going to have the same thing. What I want to do is I want to look at the limit as n approaches infinity of the nth term, which is, or the n plus 1 term. So this is the n plus 1 term. Divided by, or multiplied by the reciprocal of, the n term. So if you think you got an idea, pause the video, see how far you can get. But this has to be less than 1. Alright, so let's pretend you did that. So I have the limit as n approaches infinity of, let's see, the negative signs aren't going to matter because it's in an absolute value sign, so I can just get rid of those. Xn times x over n plus 1 times n factorial times n factorial over x to the n. Ba-da-doop, 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 ba-da-doop. And that's limit in infinity, and I can pull the x out because it's not dependent upon n. And I want to know when is that less than 1. I can say, okay, well, the absolute value of x times that limit as this goes, is actually 0. When is 0 less than 1? 0 is less than 1 always. So actually, this always converges. So this converges for all x, because it has a radius of convergence. Infinity. Good? Great. Let's try another one. So see if you can find the radius of convergence for this guy. So pause the video, see how far you can get, then come back and see what you got. So what I want to do is I want to find the limit as n approaches infinity of the n plus 1 term divided by the n term. And that limit needs to be less than 1, because it just has to get smaller over time. So if I check this out, let's see, I've got limit n approaches infinity of 2 on the top, and then n plus 1 squared still on the top, and then I have an extra x minus 1 on the top, and that 2 n was gone, I have an n squared on the bottom. And I think that's it. That looks good. Okay, I'm happy with that. This has to be lesson one. I'm going to pull the x minus 1 out. And I'm left with the limit, and I can even pull the 2 out. And I'm left with the limit as n approaches infinity of n plus 1 squared over n squared. That has to be less than 1. Now I'm going to take this guy off to the side, because there's actually a couple of different ways to solve this. I'm just going to do the limit part. There's actually a couple of different ways to solve this limit, just depending on your experience with solving for limits. So let's say I've got... I'm going to do it a couple different ways. But one way to do it is to say, okay, well, if I apply this and I just plug in infinity, I get infinity over infinity, right? So that means I can use L'Hopital's rule. I can't remember how to spell it. L'Hopital? I don't know. I had to look that up. H-O-P-I-T. I know how to say it. I just don't know how to do it. So I can do L'Hopital's rule, which basically says that I can take the limit as n equals infinity and do the derivative of the top and the bottom. So 2 times n plus 1 over 2n. Now if I put in the infinities, I get infinity over infinity again, which means I can take another derivative. Oops. Like this, and get 2 over 2, which is equal to 1. So I can get a derivative of 1 like that, or a limit of 1 like that. Another way that I could do it is I could have started off by actually multiplying it out, so n squared plus 2n plus 1 over n squared, which I still get as infinity over infinity, so I can L'Hopital it again and get 2n plus 2 over 2n and L'Hopital it again. So basically I'm just L'Hopitaling the same thing. So you're like, this isn't different. I know, but it's kind of different. So there's that. And then the third way I could do it is actually the way I would have done it initially, because I always forget about L'Hopital's rule, is if I have n squared plus 2n plus 1 over n squared, I can say, well, I'm going to multiply the top and the bottom of this equation by 1 over n squared. And if I do that, I'll get the limit as n goes to infinity of 1 plus 2 over n plus 1 over, you can't see what I'm doing, squared, plus 1 over n squared on the top, and 1 on the bottom. And then if I apply infinity, or whatever, as the limit approaches infinity, I get 1 plus 0 plus 0 over 1, which is 1. So I can get 1. Basically, the whole point is the limit of that is 1. Which is great, because I have absolute value of x minus 1 times 2 times 1 has to be less than 1. So I have the absolute value of x minus 1 has to be less than 1 half. So my radius of convergence is 1 half. And if I actually wanted to see how I could solve this out, I can kind of struggle back to college algebra. I have x minus 1 is less than 1 half, and x minus 1 is greater than negative 1 half. So add 1 to both sides. Add 1 to both sides. So basically, if I'm looking along a number line, well, I don't even know I went that far, but I know for sure that it converges between 1 half and 3 halves. Now, the endpoints, I have to check the endpoints individually. But at this point, I don't care. So I'm just trying to get a radius of convergence, and that convergence may or may not be eligible right at the endpoints. But one of the things that we care about in so far as like a Diffie-Hough kind of perspective is that if we have a power series, if it has a radius of convergence of blah, then all its derivatives too. All of its derivatives do too. So its derivatives have the same radius of convergence. So that's kind of nice, because that means that if we find a good power series that we like, that we can keep derivatizing it and derivating it and derivating it and derivating it, and we haven't really messed anything up. It still works the exact same way. It converges on the same scale. So this is very, very, very important. So one of the reasons we care about radius of convergence is because basically if we can show that it does converge, then we know that all its derivatives converge, and if all its derivatives converge, then we can actually use it to solve differential equations.